So we're gonna get started, trying to honor you guys' time. I'm hoping to be out of here in about an hour, but I will stay for questions and stuff. This is for mainly for juniors going into being seniors, but if you're not a junior going into being senior, that's totally fine too. Just know that some of the stuff, this is kind of like directed towards next year, and some of the stuff might change between now and next year too. However, in the next couple years, there's probably going to be some significant changes with a lot of stuff that's going on with the SAT and all kinds of other stuff. So just so you know, this might not necessarily be written in stone for like current sophomores. So we're going to talk mainly about what we can be doing over the summer and throughout the fall. Kind of want to start thinking about being about to be a senior. So we're about to be ready to graduate, go on to the next stage of our life. Parents, it's okay. They'll get through it. A lot of you guys, it looks like, I think, have already had a student go through the process. Some of you haven't, though. At some point tonight, I would suggest looking around the room and exchanging contact information with at least two other people. That way that you can ask questions. You can kind of have a little senior support group as you go through the process. Because it can be stressful, it can be emotional, it can be disappointing at times, too. So you want someone, you know, and I can definitely help with that too. But sometimes it's nice to talk to a peer or another parent just to be able to share where you're at in the process, what's going on, and that kind of thing. Another thing, kind of just on your desk, you have some post-it notes up there on the board. This is kind of a teacher thing, so I'm sorry. There's three columns, okay? And this is just helpful in case, like, you want certain questions to be answered. Sometimes, you know, it's nice to wait to the end if possible, but you don't want to have to remember the question the entire time. Just jot it down on the post-it note, and just feel free to get up. You don't have to like sneak or just get up, and you can post it on the parking lot. Would be like questions or something that we can maybe address at another presentation in the future. Maybe it's not too in depth that you may not know about. The idea is just, hey, this is something that would be cool to see, and then ahas are like, wow, I didn't know that. The ahas are nice for me because I know a lot of stuff, and I figure that you guys have a little bit of ideas, but sometimes I don't realize what's like brand new to you or like eye-opening and eye-shattering that I should spend more time on or focus on more. So if you just drop those down, stick those up there. I will try to go over at the end and look at the parking lot and try to address any questions up there, but just so you know. Up here in the front, I did have some pieces of paper, a lot of loose paper in this packet. This one I did only print out probably 10 or 15, just an effort to save a little bit of the trees around here. It's online, and I will show you in just a second how to access this as a PDF. I will try to print more of these as I go through, like in the fall at the next parent meeting, that kind of thing, in case you didn't get one. But if you want one to go online and read or print from home, do that. If you really want me to print you one, I can definitely do that. Just email me and say, can you please print this and give it to my kid? And I'll do that. But this is the college handbook. This is primarily focused towards four-year colleges. There's also a community college handbook that I recently put together. That's mainly for the 112 JCs, typically in California, but you know, you can look at Nevada too, and a lot of stuff in there that you should be aware of. There's one more here if you want to grab that. First come, first serve. One of these. Another one for you seniors to be. This is going to be something that you can get a start on now. In the fall, this is your senior profile. Okay, so in the fall, I'm going to be asking all of you to complete this. Not a teacher, not Ms. Mitchell, not myself will write you a recommendation without seeing this. Okay? So essentially, this is very similar to your resume. It's a little different formatting. You can supplement it with your resume. You can take stuff from your resume and put it on here. That's totally fine. But it's something that I will ask you to start on in the fall, but you can definitely get a head start and do it over the summer if you want to kind of work ahead and you're that type of student. So that's called the senior profile. And then, if I can just borrow these. One of them looks like this. This is your, so how many of you guys have heard of Naviance? Okay, we're gonna go through a little bit of that today too. This will become your best friend as a senior, or your worst enemy, depending on how you look at it. But one thing I wanted to give you guys were some instructions for SAT prep that you guys can start. There is a great SAT prep program within the Naviance software that we pay for. It would normally cost you guys about $300 each. We went out and bought kind of a group license and got a pretty good deal on it. We bought it for all students at the high school. You guys are kind of the last group of students that are going to be going through this because the SAT will be changing after you guys have to really worry about it. But if you have younger children, it will be different. But this is a great test tool that you can use over the summer, and I would highly suggest doing that. When we get to that point, I'll go over a little more detail, but this has some instructions on there. And then finally, a calendar that looks like this. This is a great publication from the College Board, who does all the AP testing and SAT tests. This just has a little bit of a brief overview of what to expect each month of the year for your senior year. Okay? Any questions so far? All right. So far, so good. See if this is going to work. All right. So tonight, we'll try to kind of go through the couple different key areas. We'll kind of look at the college landscape and what that looks like, and really try to find out what that actually entails in terms of the different levels of colleges, the different types of colleges that are out there, different types of deadlines, big fancy words, money, all that kind of thing. We're going to talk about some of the actual process, what the steps look like, what are some key things that really go wrong in the application process, as well as try to pick out the things that I find that cause the most trouble. So that's something that we're going to do too. Take a breath. It goes by quick, I promise. It's just like, you know, this year times two. But we all have a part to play. Myself, you as parents, and you as students. We all play different roles. Naturally, the student's going to be the main driving force of that role. And that's a good thing. If you're the main driving force, you know, think about yourself next year. This is just kind of a warning. If you find yourself asking the most questions and doing the most work and doing the most research, you're doing something wrong. Okay? So, if you catch yourself doing that, as a parent, you students, that's good. But as a parent, if you catch yourself doing most of the work and asking most of the questions and really driving the process, have a sit down with your kid, come talk to me. We can really work that out, but really your student should be the one driving a lot of what's going on, okay? And then we'll have some time for Q&A at the end. So, again, that college counseling handbook, that's gonna walk you through a lot of it. I wrote some of it, I borrowed some of it, I was given some of it, so it's kind of an amalgamation of a lot of different sources. But it's a pretty good kind of term, you know, have this kind of like next to your other college binders and that kind of thing, and use it if you have a question. I believe there's like a table of contents that you can go through and check out things like NCAA or financial aid or the application process in case you forget some of those. And then also, this goes for both parents and students. Please, 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 please read your emails and listen to the phone calls. Okay? I know I do the same thing. Dr. Leary gets on the phone and I see it's a phone call. Hi, this is Dr. Leary. And I'll wait for the email to come later and I'll read the email. But, you know, I highly encourage you, especially as seniors, I do a lot of reminders and a lot of updates as we go through senior year. And with that, the deadlines that go along with that are crucial. We'll talk more about deadlines later.
Can I ask, do you send those emails to the students as well as the...
Typically, I try to, yes. Not every single one will do that, but usually if I send something that's kind of applicable to both parents, that parents and students should know, I'll try to send the students a message either through their Naviance account or through a different service that I use, and then do the Blackboard Connect thing too. But it doesn't always work right, and sometimes the parents and the students have the same email address I've found. So that's kind of weird. But I do communicate often. You know, last year they said it at graduation. They'll probably say it again. We got another email from Mr. Green. It's just the easiest way to get a bunch of information out to you guys in a timely fashion. Okay, so please just read them. If you don't read the whole thing, I'll try to do a snippet at the top, like a quick summary about what's in that email. So that handbook that we ran out of, which I kind of predicted, that's okay. When you're on the website, you guys, and if you haven't been on the website, there's a lot of information on here too, but I just basically the last 2 weeks added this section here to the menu. This is the counseling menu along the top of North Tahoe School homepage. Handbook guides and resources. So it's got the four-year college advising handbook as a PDF that you can download. Right below that's the community college handbook that you can download. And then below that is something that's even cooler, is I'm putting a bunch of resources in grade level resource folders. This is basically a Dropbox folder that you can access that has a bunch of PDFs. It's got like the calendars, it's got this handbook, it's got presentations, it's got a whole bunch of information that's pretty specific to your grade level as a senior. Juniors, freshmen, and sophomores also have those folders created, and I'm And as I go throughout the year, when I find something cool, I go add it to there. So it's something that's updated. Okay, so use that. I would highly encourage you to check that piece out. All right. So a quick overview of next year. Okay, and this, and when I mean quick, it's going to be quick. So now through August, meaning this summer, through when we start school, towards the end of August. Okay, that is when a lot of your planning should be happening. We'll go in a little more depth, but that's something that, this is your big research time. I know a lot of students will work, I know a lot of students will go out and travel, and that's great. Do all those things, okay? But make sure that you don't just sit on the couch all summer and not do anything, because you're going to pay for it in the fall, okay? I see it every year, people bawling in my office because they didn't put the time in, and that's just not a fun way to spend your senior year. When they see you smiling, and how you do that is you spend the time and spread it out. Don't get so stressed out because you waited. August through December, that's typically when the majority of your applications are going to be opened and submitted. Okay, some of the applications, and we'll go through the different application types, but some of the applications will roll over into the next spring or have kind of an open-ended deadline. But your majority of them are either going to be early in the fall if you're looking at early decision, early action, and I will define those. Typically, for like the CSUs and the UCs, the California State University System and the University of California System, those are going to be opening, and they're both actually opening in August, and they August 30th, I want to say, and for like access to them, the CSUs, you can start submitting in October through end of November. The UCs, you can submit between November 1st and November 30th only. Okay, so there's some differing deadlines there, but all of the state schools, the California state schools, are all going to be due November 30th. Okay, so that's something you might want to write down on as a deadline on your calendar. And if you have like a calendar app, I will be giving you a bunch of dates. It might be a good idea to have that ready so you can find it. It's not a bad idea. And if you need me to repeat a date, that's totally fine. I'm going to try to go through this quickly so we can get out of here, but give you guys any other information. If I breeze past something you want more information on, just raise your hand and say, can you go a little more depth in that? Happy to do that. January 1st, okay? So this is this coming January, next January. That's the first day that the FAFSA, the free, and that's key, free application for federal student aid. That's basically how you're going to get qualified for things like money for school. From a lot of scholarship opportunities that schools give. And just to give you kind of a side note and a picture of the kind of money we're talking about here, I'm working on collecting all this for this year's seniors. And just to give you guys a heads up, with our 70 students graduating, and not all the 70 are part of this group, with our 70 graduates, we're at, and we're not done counting, $1.5 million for both university and local scholarships. Which is pretty cool. That's quite a bit of money. Not every one of those scholarships has been accepted, but they're all offered to the students, you know, because students apply to 5 or 6 schools, and they only pick one, but they had all this money offered to them. I mean, things like $150,000 for four, like over 4 years. Like, that's big money that you can get. It all starts with the FAFSA, okay? For people that don't have Social Security numbers, you cannot fill out the FAFSA. However, for California schools, there is a California Dream Act, which is it's a different form that you have to fill out, and it doesn't require you to be a citizen to do that. So just so you guys know that. March 2nd for this is the priority deadline, okay? And I want to make note that it's priority. The actual deadline is June 30th, okay? If you fill, you have from January 1st to June 30th to fill out the FAFSA. However, a lot of the money that the FAFSA has kind of in its money bags is finite. And it's some of it's first come, first serve. Some of it, they'll award until March 2nd, and then that goes away. So if you don't fill it out by March 2nd, and I know one of the questions that I'm going to get right now is, what if we haven't filled out our taxes? That's okay. However, if you haven't filled it out by March 2nd, you can miss out on some money. So don't do that. The taxes, because tax day is, what, April 15th, I think? Is that right?
Yeah.
I'm always early, but... April 15th, you know, not everyone's going to have their taxes in, or you have an extension. Okay, that's fine. The thing that you need to know is, for the FAFSA and the California Dream Act, you can submit with an estimate and then go back and adjust it after your taxes come back. Okay, so there's tools on the FAFSA website that you can use to kind of help you estimate based on last year's taxes. Typically, most people's taxes are relatively close year after year. If you're running a business or something like that, it gets a little more complicated. But just so you know, you can submit. I mean, you can submit it January 1st with an estimate. You just have to remember to go back and change it later. Okay, so that's the FAFSA, and that's really the start of the financial aid season. January through June, that's big. That's our big kind of scholarship season, both from the schools. Schools will sometimes have scholarship applications on their websites, specific to that specific university or even departmental major. So maybe there's a Cal Poly Engineering application that's separate from the Cal Poly application. So that's why it's important when you're looking at schools online that you go to all the websites and you kind of dig in a little bit. And that's great summertime work, creating a little Google Drive folder or a notebook or whatever it might be, and writing down all the different websites, if they have scholarships, any special deadlines for the schools that you're thinking about applying to. And then May 1st is what we would call National Decision Day. Okay, May 1st is the day that most schools will expect both a commitment, meaning an online, yes, I'm coming, and a deposit. Okay, so that's a good time to have some money in the bank. And it's not a ton of money. It's not like, you know, half of the tuition. It's usually, you know, between $150 to probably $1,000 maximum, depending on the school that you're going to be attending. Okay, but sometimes that's stuff that you need to plan for. So it's always a good idea to have money right around then. Make sure your account has some in there so that you can put that money down. If you don't make it a positive decision, sometimes your admissions results disappears. Okay, and you're kind of out of luck there. So that's a good date to write down too. So this fall and throughout the summer, we're going to be wanting to populate a list. And we've talked about this at another, I think our junior meeting is kind of went over what that list might look like. My recommendation, and it's kind of asking this here when it's asking you, do you have enough schools? My recommendation, 5 to 10 is a pretty good number, anywhere in between. Anything less than 5, you run the risk of not getting in. Okay? College is a competitive environment for everybody. Doesn't matter if you're a straight A, 4.85 GPA, you know, perfect SAT score, you can still not get in somewhere. I've seen it happen. I hear about it happening all the time. The likelihood of that happening is small, but you do not want to be the one person that it happens to. Okay, so don't put all your eggs in one basket. You know, it might cost you a little more time and a little bit, you know, more application fees to add 2 or 3 applications to your list and your process for next year, but it will pay off. Because sometimes, one, you don't get into the one that you want to get into and you need some backup plans. And two, you change your mind. You know, think about just in the last year, how many of you guys changed your mind about your hair color or, thanks, Cam. you know, all that kind of, like, you guys, seniors and adolescents in general are pretty wishy-washy in terms of where they're at. They're going to hear something, oh, my friend's going here. Now that's their new best school. Okay? So what you start with in the fall and where you apply may not in the spring be where you actually want to go. The other reason would be sometimes, you know, when you're doing college applications, it's kind of like reverse shopping. All right. So what I mean by that is when you're shopping at a store, you go in with your list and we'll have that list. But then you go in also with a budget and a price and you can see the price. Okay, I want Cheerios and I want milk, but not the organic milk that's like $8. I want the regular cheapo milk. And you go in and you know how much you're going to be spending. When you're applying to college, though, it's reverse. You're going in and you have no idea how much you're going to be spending at that point. They're going to give you the sticker price, like when you're shopping for a car, that says, okay, average cost of attendance for a year is $35,000. All right, that $35,000 is an average. And it's for the average student. Sometimes, you know, if you're looking at a state East Coast, it typically doesn't include things like multiple cross-country airfares or airfare for your whole family to go see them. Okay, that's going to add a significant amount of money to that package. However, where was I going with this? My brain just... reverse shop. So when you do that, one thing that can actually change your mind when you're looking at that list is you might get your financial aid package back in like late March from those schools, and then you have to compare them and say, okay, which one can I actually afford? Your top school might be way out of the picture. And so you have to have some of those options back in place. If you only picked one school, guess what? If you're gonna go to school or you're not gonna like look at these other kind of like later options, you're going to have to either, you know, maybe eat $40,000 a year in loans and whatever it might be to go to school, or wait a whole year. Okay, so that's another reason why it's really important to have a couple varying lists. And these lists that we're building, remember, we're talking about reach, fit, and safe schools. All right? Academically, that's what we're looking for. Financially, that's what we're looking for too. Okay, so you have to kind of categorize them as both. You want a good fit academically. You want to like have some reach schools being, you know, I'm a pretty good student. I really would love to go to Harvard, and I'm going to throw in my application. Okay, Harvard, Stanford, Yale, MIT, those kind of schools, nobody gets into those schools. Okay, you are the exception, not the rule, if you get into those schools. So, you know, I think it's like something down to the ridiculousness of like 3.7% this year. Okay, it's pretty outrageous if you get in there. So that's not that would definitely be your reach of a reach school. So you need one or two of those though. For some students, that might be Cal Poly, or it might be San Francisco State. So those are all great reach schools, depending on kind of what your academic profile looks like. Good fit schools are going to be kind of right in that middle zone, that kind of like not too hot, not too cold range. And when you're looking at the good fit, what you're looking for is schools that are going to challenge you academically, going to have the programs that you're looking for, but they're not going to be so outrageous to get into that the odds are totally against you. So that's going to be typically, you know, a good fit would be kind of like anywhere between, when you're looking at kind of admissions rates for prior years, anything above 15% or kind of 15% or below is going to be a pretty big reach school for almost anybody. Many people are going to get rejected to that school. Between like 20 and maybe 40% of students admitted is a pretty good reach school kind of for your criteria. You, in your Naviance account, and I'll show you a little bit about that, you can actually look up and see what the data is, both from our school and schools across the country in terms of average SAT, average GPA, that kind of thing. That's all really good information that you need to know while you're researching. And then safe schools, and I put an asterisk there because, like I said, no school is a safe school. All right, so it's just kind of like a concept that's not a guarantee. That's going to be a school that you have a pretty good shot at getting into. Not because it's a lousy school, but because, you know, UNR is not by no means a lousy school. However, they're not as popular, you know, they would not be considered as maybe popular as, say, Cal Poly. It's easier to get into because the demand is lower. So does that make sense? So that would be a great safe school for many students. It's close by. Many of our students are able to get admitted somewhat. You know, it's pretty good odds of getting in there. Okay. Sacramento State is also a great safe school. One, because it's close by. Two, as long as you're meeting the CSU UC A through G requirements and you have a 3.0 or above, they're in what's called our local area, meaning we're essentially guaranteed admissions to CSU Sacramento State. All right. So that's a great backup school. However, with all these, they need to be kind of all first choice schools, and that's hard because you got 5 or 10 of them. How can they all be first choice? Doesn't mean that you don't have a hierarchy of which ones you'd rather attend. However, you need to be able to pick. Say, you know, if you got into 2 out of the 5 that you applied to, you better be happy going to each of those ones, and you can have your choice, or even 1 out of the 5. You better be happy with what that college is. Okay, so being able to do that research will help you do that. And I'm more than happy, you know, if you want some help with that, I'm happy to help. We'll go through this a little more in depth next year with the students, kind of hands-on. But if you want to set up some time to sit down and go through it, I'm happy to do that. One thing that's really helpful to me, students in particular, is in your Naviance Family Connection account, under the colleges area, there's an area that you can enter schools that you're interested in. It's called your prospective school list. Okay. What's nice about that is anytime I talk to you, anytime I look anything up about you, I can pull that up, and I typically do. I'll pull it up and see what you're looking at. That way I don't have to spend 5 minutes asking you all about, you know, because you guys get tired of it too. Of what are you doing next year? Remind me what's going on. I can look it up. I can look straight at it and say, oh, you know, I see that you're looking at UCSB, you know, San Diego State. You must be looking at, like, going to the beach and kind of going to, like, you know, a pretty good beach school. Have you thought about, like, Long Beach? Okay, and we can have those conversations, and it kind of helps me prepare for any type of meeting that we have. So as you're doing your research, I would highly suggest that you start populating that list. Okay, it's pretty easy to do. At the end, if I have some time, I can get online and actually demo it for you, I think. But it doesn't really lend itself to pictures to be able to show you how to do that. And again, start completing that senior profile, because that's how the beginning of your recommendations will go. Your teachers will not write you one. I will not write you one without a completed senior profile. One thing that's nice is every college is going to have an admissions counselor. And typically they'll have regional admissions counselors, unless it's a really small school. The counselors are usually assigned to like a geographical region. Some of the bigger schools, it might be all of California. Some of the schools with more staff, it might be Northern California or certain counties within a state. And those are the people that you're going to want to kind of have written down in that notebook. Because sometimes you'll come and ask me a question, and I wish I knew everything. I don't. And many times with colleges, I kind of play the safe card, and I'm going to say either you guys should contact the college or I'll help you contact the college, and we'll ask them directly. Because policies change. They don't send out these like beep, 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 news bulletins saying, guess what, something's changed. In big instances, they do. But many times, the school's going to know right off the bat, and they're the authority in their own school. So when there's any time I have a question or I'm not sure about something, I will always refer you to contacting the school directly. And many times that's going to be the admissions department until you're actually admitted. So looking up when you're doing your research, finding the college counselor, the admissions counselor that's kind of assigned to us would be a good thing to have written down. Secondly, when you guys are going, and summer's a great time to do this, if you guys have any family vacations, and I've told you guys this all the time, that I keep on wanting to plug this because it's super important. This traveling and visiting a school is the number one way to know that you want to go there. You can look at it online, you can look at all the pamphlets, you can get it all drummed up and talk to your friends who have gone there, but until you actually see it, it's not something that you are able to really kind of like internalize. It's just a picture on a website or it's a picture on a brochure. When you walk around and you kind of get the feel, you're able to go to the dining commons, you're able to see what the dorms look like, that makes your school experience and kind of your choice real. I've had students take their top school, visit it, and say, nope, not for me. And take a school that they have never even heard of, visit it, and say, this is where I belong. Because that's how much the visit actually makes a difference. Not only is it just like the academics, but it's also the environment the school's in, kind of their culture. Do they have certain sporting events? How big are their sporting events? Is it like a big, D1, everyone's at the football game with shirts off and stuff like that? Or is it, a school that people just kind of like hang out on the quad and throw a frisbee around? Like, those are going to attract different types of people. Recommendations. So not every school is going to require recommendations. However, you should, when you start looking at them, these are all pieces and nuggets of information to look for. Recommendations are things that take planning ahead. Because, I know your teachers love you, I know I love you guys. When 60 people come asking me for letters all at the same time, it takes me a couple hours to write each of them. And your teacher's the same thing. And I even had the luxury of like being able to shut my door and not have class. They don't. So if you're going to ask teachers for recommendations, one, start identifying who those teachers are and start buttering out now. Okay. Cookies, coffee, that kind of stuff really help. That kind of like greases the recommendation wheel. And, when you're doing that, identify them and then start reminding them. Say, hey, Miss J, who seems to be the most popular teacher to get recommendations from, I would really love it. I feel like you know me well as a student, as a person. Would you consider, and always, always, always ask for recommendation. Do not ever demand one. If a student comes and demands, write me a recommendation, I will say no. Okay? It's not our job. It's not a teacher's job. So please, students especially, ask for a recommendation. It's no one's responsibility to write a recommendation. It's our privilege and our honor to write you one. Okay? However, we do need things like time. I suggest most of our teachers, I require 2 weeks minimum. So if your thing is due November 15th, you probably should have that in to be by November 1st. Okay, so I have time, because typically if you give me that, I'm going to have more behind, you know, more in front of you waiting to get done. Okay, so, you know, when you're thinking about that, we will review this later. But it's a very strong, this is one of the recommendations, other than kind of your transcripts and some of your extracurriculars, say a lot about you as a student. Because they're always, in most, I would say 99% of the case, confidential. I do tend to like to show myself, I'll submit one and I'll usually give the student a copy of the recommendation just because I think it's fun, I like doing the same thing when I get one. It's fun to see what people are saying about you. I'm not like talking trash and, sending a bad one. And I won't send a bad one. If I can't write you a good letter, I'll just tell you, I'm sorry, I can't write you a letter. I don't feel like I know you well enough. I don't feel like it would be a strong recommendation. And college admissions people can read through that. If it's just like, they're a good student, they show up every day, and they got 3 C's and an A, that's it. That doesn't really tell you a whole lot about a student. They're looking for personal information about you as a student, as a person. You know, they were super interested in me in my class. They always were the first hand up. They always were on the announcements, making, getting up in front of the student body, leading the cheer, whatever it might be. All those things are what kind of boost you up as an applicant over someone else. It's not necessarily the grades. It's not necessarily anything else. That's what you're looking for. As you get through also, guys, into that application season, there are things for certain schools, like essays, personal statements. Some schools require resumes. If you're looking at more of a performance or a kind of like art review type of school, they're going to require a portfolio or an audition. And those things are all stuff that you can start thinking about now. The Common App, which is something that I'll talk about in just a second. Common App is an application that encompasses over 500 schools across the country and actually around the world. And what the Common App does is it pulls all these schools' applications. Instead of having to fill out one for this one for this one, you fill out an overall general one, and then a short, specific application, typically by each school that you're applying to under the Common Application. See, it shortens the work. However, they will require essays. The Common App essays are already out. So you can go Google 2015-16 Common App essay topics, and you can see what's out there for you to choose from. That's something that you might want to start looking at this summer. Start thinking, and not even if you don't even start writing the essay, that's fine. That's not something you necessarily need to start this summer. Have your eyes open for opportunities to notice what you should write about. That's what I think the summer should be about, looking back about your experiences in the past, but being extra like aware of what you're doing at your internship, your job, your travel experiences, whatever it might be, your sporting activities, that might kind of lend themselves to those specific essay topics. Because if you're not paying attention, it's not good to make something up. You want to find something that's real, that's actually you. Okay, so that's for the essay topics. Always check your work. I am very happy to review essays, review resumes, review your applications. Sometimes I'm busier than others, check in with me and see when might be a good time to do that or make an appointment. But I love reviewing that stuff. You know, surprised how many people go and submit it without letting me even look it over. And almost every time I do, I find something wrong, an error, or a misspelling, or something omitted. Okay, so please, I encourage you, ask me to do that. I will probably suggest you also find an English teacher or someone that's really good at English to do that, because that's not my forte, to check like things like spelling, grammar, all that kind of thing. Okay? But always check it, because many times when you're doing these applications, whether it's a scholarship application or a college application, you hit that submit button and that thing is gone forever. So if you misspelled your name, like many people do on their SATs, that's your name on your college application now. Okay? So there's no, yeah. You can have a 9 in your middle.
That's easier, right?
Yeah. So always double check. Triple check. I can't say it enough about deadlines. Especially next year. You know, I tend to put deadlines out there and I try to stick to them, and I always try to think ahead and put it a day or two before I actually need it, because I know that there's always going to be someone that doesn't make a deadline, and that's real life. I get it. They don't do that. Okay? If they say it's due November 30th at midnight or 11:59 p.m. and it's, you know, 12:01 a.m., whatever, December 1st, you missed the boat. There's no, like, calling the office and saying, oh, I didn't know, my computer died, I was traveling, I didn't have internet. Okay, they're going to tell you, you should have planned ahead. So when we're talking about deadlines, about especially college applications, scholarships, that kind of thing, it's a dead solid deadline. So make sure that you know when it is. Make sure that you know what time zone it's in if you're going to be pushing the deadline. Because there are that makes a big difference. Sometimes, you know, they'll say midnight, but the server's on the East Coast, so it's midnight East Coast time, okay? Which is like 9 o'clock or something here, okay? So that makes a big difference. So make sure that you know that. Make sure that you submit all your applications. You'd be surprised how many people, like, go through the entire process and forget to, like, pay or forget to hit submit. Many times you'll hit submit, and then it'll take you to a payment option. You'll be like, oh, I don't have my credit card. And you'll think you're submitted. You're not. Make sure that you have, every time you submit something, at least like digitally, you're going to get typically a confirmation email and something that you should print out. Stick it somewhere safe. Because if that disappears, or if like you get something back later that says, well, we're still missing your application, you're like, no, I have my confirmation number. You know, this will show that I got it in on time at least. Maybe you have to go and redo it somehow because the computer died on their side, but you can show that you met their deadline. Again, Naviance, I'm going to ask you guys constantly to be updating it, because that, one, tells me that I should submit your stuff on your behalf, and two, it lets me follow along in your progress. I can also check deadlines and say, hey, I know there's a deadline coming up for you next week because I saw that you're applying early admissions. Have you submitted it? It doesn't look like you've updated your account yet. You know, if you keep it updated, I won't bug you, and two, it makes me a little less stressed on your behalf. Transcripts. I know this is like a water hose, guys. I am recording it, just so you know, in case you want to go back and tag different things. And again, remember, if you have questions or want more information, put the little post-its up. Serious, we'll do it. Transcripts are not something that are automatically sent. Okay, many people think that transcripts just automatically appear at college. They don't. Transcripts are required to be requested, and typically requested by the student when you need it sent. With the exception, typically, of the common application. And that's something I won't cover tonight. That's something I'll cover like next year. But anytime you need a mid-year transcript, anytime that you need a transcript for the CSUs, anytime you need a final transcript, which is like the school that you've been accepted to, you put your deposit down, and after you've graduated, you have to request all those. They don't automatically go. Okay. Two ways to do that. One is through parchment.com. That's kind of the roundabout way, and it's going to cost you a little bit of money. Most of you guys, for many of your schools, they'll accept electronic transcripts, and you can submit them electronically free through your Naviance account. Okay, there will be certain schools, and there are some CSUs and UCs that only accept paper transcripts. The only way to do that is through Parchment, because we don't actually mail them. We upload them, and they mail them out for us. Okay, and that's why it costs a little bit of money. And then keep focusing on your academic work throughout your senior year. Do not let senioritis set in. That they do, and they will rescind your admissions. Okay, if you're a straight A student and you're like, okay, I'm gonna work really hard first semester so they see it on my transcript for the first semester, and then I'm just gonna like go to the beach all spring semester, and you get C's. If you're applying to some of those competitive schools, they will say, yeah, we expected you to keep this. Like, we don't really want someone who's just gonna like kind of cruise at the end of the year. And they'll yank your admissions. Okay, so please don't let that get to you. Every senior is going to go through it. I mean, every person at work goes through it. It's just a time, like, you're just kind of over it. You have to battle it. Okay, and you know, we'll try to remind you, but parents, that's something you can do too. If you see them starting to slack off, make sure that you're on their case in a supportive way, not like putting them under your toe and smashing them. But really, that's something that you guys can help with as well. Before we get into types of applications, I just want to remind parents in particular, sometimes it's a temptation to step in and do a lot of this for the student. It's a temptation to kind of pick the schools, to fill out the applications, to do all the research, to do all this stuff. And not only is that something that's not really helpful to the student, it really steals the opportunity from the student to do it. Okay? The hard part is when your student doesn't really want to do it. Or they put it off and you're like a type A and they're not a type A person. And you really want them to get it done. And they're like, I would rather do anything else but college applications right now. And they will hit that point. Okay? You have to start, like, one, create a plan now of how you're going to handle that as a couple or as a family unit or whatever you might be. Okay, sit down and say, okay, what are we going to do? Are we going to try to do this for them? Or are we going to let them struggle and maybe even miss a deadline? Okay, for a certain school. So I would not recommend the deadline one. That's something that you're like, okay, I'll pay you $20 if you sit down and do this. Because deadlines don't change. But if you know if they're just gonna wait and be stressed out, that's something that I would say let them wait and let them be stressed out because they waited to the last minute. Okay, but try to make sure that they're not gonna miss that deadline. And I'll do the same thing. I'm not gonna badger them all the time. I'm not gonna like push them that hard to get things in. If they're not really interested in it, I got other things I can focus on, other students to worry about. You know, if they're ready to go, I'm 110% there, okay? And, I'm going to, like, try to get them ready to go. But to a certain level where I'm going to do it for them or you're going to do it for them, don't do that, please. It just creates a false sense of security. And we want you guys as students to experience the college application season. As stressful as it is, it's also very fun and exciting. Just like going to college. It's very stressful and scary, but it's super exciting when you go. So we want you guys to have that opportunity to do it. So the different types of applications, all right? And I'm sorry for people in the back, this is kind of small. This is my first time of presenting on this thing. It's like the best Super Bowl party ever. However, there's a couple different types of applications in colleges that you need to be aware of. Okay, the first one up at the top is called the Common Application. We kind of talked a little bit about that. That's the 500 schools. They have this overarching application and then more specific school-focused applications that fall underneath it. There are school-specific applications. Some of the schools that have common application, they may also have a school-specific application. Most of the time, I would suggest using the common app, mainly because that's what many schools are starting to turn towards. The kind of one exception that might apply would be sometimes schools, and many times kind of the smaller schools, will send out like application waivers in the mail or something like that and say, hey, you know, we'd love for you to apply, you seem like a good fit. If that's a school that you're interested in applying to, many times that application fee waiver will not go to the Common App, it'll go to their specific school app. Okay, and they both go into the same pool, they many times cover the same thing, but odds are if you're going to do that app, if you have another app that's going to use Common App, just use the Common App. Don't do two different school applications. Universal application, I've never used a universal application. It's typically not something that most people do. Common Black College application, don't need that one right now. Unless you really want to go to an HBCU. Priority applications. So there's some different types of applications and deadlines. I forget, is that what's on my next screen? All right. I'll talk about that next. Some of them have that priority application. That's something that will typically will be kind of like targeted at a certain type of student. A lot of times it's like national merits finalists, or they'll like get a list of kids with certain SAT scores or whatever it might be, and they might solicit priority applications saying, hey, if you fill this in, one, we're going to waive your application, and two, you kind of get priority access to the admissions decision field. Again, these are going to be typically your smaller applications. Or smaller colleges and schools that maybe are on the not as kind of like impacted or like people banging down the doors to get in type of school. Same thing with FAST application. We see less and less of those. Your top ones are going to be the ones that we're going to see the most of. The two California ones that you're going to see, the CSU, the California State University, that's the 23 campuses around the state, Long Beach, Sacramento State, San Francisco State, that kind of stuff. They use this, what's called CSU Mentor. Okay. And that's their application. And what's the CSUs, if you're going to apply to CSU, that's the easiest application you're ever going to do. Okay, it's really, really easy. If you have a transcript in front of you, you can fill it out probably in like 30 minutes. It's pretty dang simple. You do want to make sure that it's accurate. You want to make sure that you spend your time on it. But there's no essay. There's no recommendations. It's literally you're going to fill it in. You actually can check the different schools you want to go to, and it's going to, the same application is going to go to all the ones that you check. The only difference is each one of them, you're going to, it's like $79, $107, you know, it's just going to be adding more money towards that. And for most applications as well, there's also fee waivers available if you qualify for your finances, and that'll waive typically a certain number of applications depending on the system that you're going to be applying to. But things like it'll apply to Common App, and then you'll have the same thing with the CSUs. So if you have free opportunities to apply, say with the CSUs, and you're going to apply to one CSU, if you have three opportunities to do it, you know, three applications, pick two other ones and send it in. You know, just ones you may want to possibly consider. It doesn't hurt anything. You can always say no. Yes?
With regards to the CSU, we've not needed an essay or recommendation, so you just put in this fast app to CSUs?
Kind of, yeah. So that might be a fast app, yeah. It's not going to come already filled out, but it's going to be...
Maybe not a fast app.
Yeah. Okay. The non-rigorous application. It's going to be some, so the CSUs are going to basically admit your student based on, it's kind of the least fun and the least holistic approach. You become essentially a formula, and that's where a lot of people get the idea of like GPA and class rank and all this stuff really matter. CSU, it does, to a certain level. Because they're gonna basically give you a number based on a mathematical formula, and that's kind of how they sequence you in terms of the applicants. So it's a little less like, you know, they're not going to look at who you are as a person.
Not much matter of basic personality or any of that.
Yeah.
Really...
So it's really really kind of nuts and bolts of an application. But most students are going to get into a CSU. You might have to look at the different CSUs that are out there. But that's what the CSU system is designed for. It's designed to be a little bit less rigorous to get into certain campuses and be there for students who maybe aren't the Harvard student or whatever it might be. But a Harvard student can definitely go to CSU and find great success and be a perfect fit for them too. All right, how are we doing? I know, it's long. My brain is like melting right now. Different types of applications. So along with the different application types, there's different deadline types as well. Okay. And so the main ones that you're going to see are going to be, one, rolling admissions. So UNR is a good example. Montana State's also a good example of a rolling admissions school. Rolling admission basically means that, you know, they're going to have a window of time that their application is open. You know, say August 1st till March 2nd or something like that, they're going to have their application open. And at any time during that application window, a student can go on there, complete their application, and typically within a couple weeks to maybe a month and a half, they're going to spit out a result, not waiting for any type of deadline. So over that month and a half, as they're processing, more students are submitting their applications. And so what happens is, it's nice because you can actually get, an admissions decision back pretty quickly from a school. Again, these are some of the schools. Typically you'll see rolling admissions at a school where it's not going to be quite as difficult to get in, as long as you meet some of their basic requirements. That's typically why they have the rolling admissions, because they're not having to wait and kind of compare, you know, 50,000 students. They're able to kind of process it based on your merits at that time and say, yes, you meet our requirements, we're going to spit back this application result that says accepted. So that's rolling admissions. There are other deadlines that happen with rolling admissions, but that's kind of what the overall application looks like. Regular decision is going to be kind of your quote-unquote standard college application, meaning, you know, for the CSU system, you know, the November 30th, that's going to be your regular deadline. As a whole, CSU and UC do not have any early application or early deadlines or stuff like that. Specific campuses, that's why, you know, you want to look at the specific campuses within the system. Some places like Cal Poly and some of those other schools have started to add their own typically departmental early deadlines. So just do a little research on terms of that. I don't have a specific list of which CSUs and which campuses and programs have those early deadlines. So as you're looking, not only look at the school, but look at kind of the specific major, or at least like school of science or school of engineering, whatever it might be. Look at that specific school that you might be considering to see if there's any special requirements. Early action is an opportunity for a student to basically demonstrate that they're very interested in that specific school. So early action, and the main difference here between early action and early decision is one is binding and one is not binding. Early action is not binding. And what that means is non-binding is you, if you decide not to go there, there's no penalty to you, okay? Early decision means, and I say typically a lot because there's not really black and white science in college admissions, so as soon as I say 100%, there's going to be something that comes in that's not. But in most cases, the early decision, you're going to apply to that school early, and you're signing an agreement, you and your parent are signing an agreement that if I'm admitted to this school, I'm going to cancel every single one of my other applications, and I'm going to put a deposit down now. And if I don't, you're going to come after me for tuition. Okay, so it's a big decision. And that's a huge thing that you need to research. Because if you do an early decision application, it is a legal binding document. Okay? Does that mean that they're going to come and sue you? Probably not. There will be some sort of penalty that you'll be required to pay, or they might come after you legally. Because it's that big of a deal. That's going to say to a school that I'm your first choice, your only choice. If you admit me, and that's a great way. If you're like kind of on the edge and you want to like shoot for some of these REIT schools and that's your number one choice and you know it for sure, early decision is a way to kind of take you from being kind of like the average applicant to be like, yes, that's, because it's a sure thing for that college. Colleges admit, when they're doing the application processing, they'll spit back 10,000 acceptances, you know, hypothetically, only really wanting 3,000 back. Because they know kids are going to apply to 10 schools. Not everyone that we accept is going to enroll. Okay, but by doing this, they can get the top students they know are they're not really having to take a risk. They have a sure bet in hand. And that's why they make it a binding contract. Early action is all that without the kind of legal consequence and the money consequence. Usually, early action, they're going to say, you can only apply to one school early action. And you're basically, you'll check a box sometimes saying, this is my only school, I'm applying early action. But it doesn't prevent you from applying to other places. And if you don't end up going, if there's no penalty, it's kind of just a little bit of a heads up. And it's a little bit of like a notch in your belt saying, you know, that you're my favorite school of what I'm applying to. Okay, but it's a little less limiting. Any questions about this? This is always a good one to ask questions about.
I see how you can do only one early decision, but can you do more than one early action?
It depends on the schools that you're applying to. Some schools will say yes. Another school that you know, Drew might be applying to will say no. So you have to kind of be the least restrictive environment, or I guess the most restrictive environment is going to be the one that you have to follow. So if one school says you can apply to as many early action schools as you want, great. But if another one says you can only apply to one early action, you should follow that requirement for that school.
So you have to get quite a ways into the website to answer that question. I mean,
that's where calling the admissions office is a good thing. It's typically in the application, but yeah, it can be buried, and it can be in kind of like the terms and services. You know, your firstborn child, PIN number, all that stuff. But if you don't read it, you wouldn't know. So that's pretty important especially if you're looking at doing any of those. Most of the time with the early action, it's usually like honor system. They're not going to have like, they don't usually have some system like cross-check, and like, it's usually like honor system where I'm promising that this is my only early action school. There's not usually a system that they can use to check that. But I don't want to promise that, because as soon as I say that, someone's going to be like,
how many kids actually do either one of those?
Kind of depends by the year. We always have, every year I'll have early actions. Not every year I'll have early decisions.
Okay.
Kind of depends on how much research they've done, how solid they feel. Finances also come into play because, you know, like I said, it's reverse shopping. So if you do an early decision and you haven't done your research about the finances and stuff and kind of like thought about what kind of financial aid package you're going to get back, you could be also stuck in a bad situation. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
question on the early decision. Do they open up more scholarship opportunities in your early decision or not? Is that kind of hit or miss?
Yeah, depends a lot.
Doesn't the percentage go up too? And that's why a lot of people do the early decision.
Yeah, your chances of getting in
are greater.
Yeah, your chances of getting in with early decision are typically much greater.
Yeah.
Early action is a little bit better than regular decision usually. It's a little less, it's kind of like split in the middle sometimes. It really depends on a lot of like your other application materials and what the school looks like and that kind of thing. Yeah.
If you were applying to, say, several of the UCs, but one was definitely more of a choice than another, can you choose one of those? Do they share the same application?
They share the same application, but once you hit submit, they're going to spit out to the different sites.
So you couldn't pick one, like, that's my first choice, but if I get in, I guess...
No.
So you can't choose an early decision...
No, not so unless they change anything for this year, most of the UCs and CSUs, there's not going to be any type of early action. But again, like I said, check the specific school's websites and the specific departmental, because I have seen several, like, not necessarily early action, but like a priority, more of a priority deadline of you get it in by now and it's a little bit better. But they don't typically do early, they won't do early decision. I haven't seen many early actions. And CSUs especially, UCs are starting, they're like starting to change because of the demographics and kind of the population that's coming into the application. Every year it grows, so they're trying to figure out ways to help them make decisions on the admissions kind of committee teams.
So if there's not an early action date, you might look for a priority kind of date? Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions? Good questions. The last thing I'll say about this, because I did mention the financial aid piece and you might get stuck. There's typically a way around it if, like, you do early decision and, you know, your house burns down and all of a sudden, like, you lost a job or something like that. Financial aid department has the ability to make certain decisions and certain powers, and that's really helpful when you might be stuck in something. That doesn't mean that they'll let you out, but they might be able to work with you in some way. So if you guys do that, I don't want to scare you out of early decision. I just want to make sure you make an informed decision if you do that. So a little bit, I kind of talked about some of this stuff. So my role is kind of support and guide you guys through this process, both parents and students. I like to answer a lot of questions, receive feedback, offer suggestions. You know, I'm not going to be the one that's going to pick the schools for you. I want you to kind of guide that process, but I'm happy to help you kind of brainstorm and talk about what your thoughts might be in terms of your schools that you might be looking at. I'd love to review application materials. I will advocate to schools on your behalf. Say, for example, like you failed a certain class and then your family went through divorce or something like that. Schools don't necessarily see that on a transcript, and that's not something you typically will write in an essay. So stuff like that, that's kind of where I come in as kind of like the mediator or advocate between certain schools. If there's certain special circumstances that schools need to know about where you guys are as a family, that's my job as well. And to help you troubleshoot any problems that really arise, because there are things that come up that are, you know, I submitted the wrong number on my FAFSA or whatever it might be. Like I said, I don't always have all the answers, but I have a pretty good resource of where to look and a pretty good base of knowledge to know kind of some of the answers you might come into. A lot of the stuff that I see kind of having issues or troubleshooting problems are stuff that I've addressed before in past years, so many times it can roll over into the next one. But like I said, Navient Family Connection students, this is going to be coming new Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat. Okay, except for all the fun part. I mean, it's kind of fun. It really can be like the power that's behind some of this tool. You know, if you've used it quite a bit, you realize this. But it's something that you can use to do all this research. All this research is right in your fingertips. It's something that you can. Create a plan and use it to communicate with me, to access contacts for admissions departments, for financial aid departments at the specific schools. Plus it also helps you contact the admissions office, requesting transcripts, letting me know that it's time for you to submit materials on your behalf, that kind of thing. So I'll work with you seniors a little bit more in depth about the Navient stuff in the beginning of the school year, because you'll forget it all over the summer.
Test results, does that go through Navient, or do you do that through College Board?
Good question. So no, not through Navient. So when you're looking at test results, so typically when you apply, you're going to submit your application. Most applications are going to say either submit your transcript now, or they'll give you a date to submit your transcript. Some of them are later. And they'll also typically ask for things like test scores. This could be your ACT, your SAT. Some of them will ask for AP scores early. Most of them won't need your AP scores. you'll typically just write them in and they'll trust you and you'll send them at the, you know, when you're graduated and admitted. But you will send your SAT and ACT scores in an official manner. The only way to do that is through either the SAT or the ACT website. And you'll send them directly to the school. So say you apply to Sacramento State. Once you apply, if they ask for your SAT scores, you're going to get on the College Board website where you registered for the SAT, and then you'll go online and order an official score report, and those get sent. And say that you submit on November 30th and you have a December test. What you're going to submit on the application is going to say, I'm planning on taking this test in December. You'll enter the test date, but you'll leave the scores blank. After your test date and your scores come back, then you'll typically send your results. So you don't need to send them multiple times in most cases. Kind of after your last test score and after you've applied, you don't need to really send them before you apply. They're not like collecting a whole bunch of test scores from students when they don't have application profiles for them, just keeping them hoping you're going to apply. They're really going to toss that. They're not going to process those. They're going to wait until you have an application on file, and then they're going to add that information to your application. So it's not a bad idea to send them when you're, you know, doing your SATs, because it's free, who cares, but you're probably going to have to send them again once you've actually applied and picked some schools. Naviance is not a substitute for conversations with your parents or me, okay? It's a great source of information. However, so is the National Enquirer, okay? It all depends on how you read it and how you look at it. Something can be deceiving that might be, you know, might mean something else, and you might think it means this, that, or the other. Okay, so as you're looking at stuff, ask questions. Ask your parents, ask me, ask your teachers, ask Ms. Mitchell, ask Blanca. And we're happy to kind of decipher some of those things. It's not also a tool to just like mass apply to schools. Okay. So the Common App is actually integrated with your Naviance account. So you won't, if you apply to Common App schools, you must use your Naviance account. There's not an option. I will send recommendations. Your teachers will send recommendations. You'll request recommendations through your Naviance account for things like the Common App. Other schools, it's a little more, it's not quite tied together. But we can still send things like transcripts. And it's not static. It's going to take information from you. If you're just expecting it to be awesome, just showing up and, you know, kind of like your Instagram feed, you're just scrolling through and new stuff happens every time, that's not really how it works. Okay, so it's going to ask you for information, and you're going to give some information, and it's going to spit back even greater information. So keeping it updated is going to make it actually useful to you. All right, so I'm conscious of our time, so I'm going to try to get through some of this stuff. Financial aid, that's always a huge question. I don't feel like I would be getting you guys ready for the summer and the fall without talking a little bit about financial aid, because college is expensive. There's no way around it. You're going to have to pay something for college in most likelihood. Okay, some of you more than others. And that's where it's a little more complicated, and why the financial aid piece is always a tricky subject, because every family is going to be in a different situation. So it's really hard to kind of cover in depth in a group, because your family's going to be different than this one, and your finances and what their school's requirements are going to be. But the big kind of bullet points are this. Be realistic. Okay, don't lie to your kids. Say, we're going to pay for whatever school that you want to go to. Okay, that doesn't really help anybody, because it gets hopes up that this is the only school for me, and then you might actually be on the hook for paying for that school or disappointing your son or daughter. Okay, so be realistic with your kids. Talk about where you're at financially, what you can support and what you can't. That might mean you guys as a couple or as a family unit sit down and discuss finances. You have that kind of big, hairy, audacious conversation of realistically, what can we put towards college? And, you know, I always suggest adding that number to that list of search tools. We can realistically, out of pocket, pay $10,000 a year. Your kid needs to know that when they're researching. Because if they're looking up only things that are going to cost $50,000, there's going to be a gap in financial aid that you're not going to be able to cover. Okay, so make sure that they know kind of family-wise what the expectation is. That doesn't mean that you're going to have to pay $10,000, but they know kind of that's what, apart from student loans or grants and scholarships, that's what they can expect from mom and dad, or grandma and grandpa, or your 529, or whatever it might be. Okay, get an estimate. All right. There's different cost of attendance. That's a word that you'll start hearing. Cost of attendance calculators that you can use. Sometimes the school itself will have a cost of attendance calculator. On Naviance, in all the financial aid tabs of each individual school, it's going to give you your average cost of attendance. I think it's going to be from the previous year. So you can kind of use that as an estimate. But again, remember the cost of attendance is an average. And it's also like your MSRP on a car. Okay, it's what they're suggesting as your base cost. And that's going to include things like room and board, food, slight book allowance usually, and then tuition. All right. But your family might be a little bit different in terms of what your needs are, because that cost of attendance is going to be the overall what they're going to look for you. When you submit the FAFSA and things like scholarships and grants, they're going to use that information, which is basically your tax information, to spit out a number called an EFC, which is your expected family contribution. That's how much your family is going to be expected to pay each year. So remember, 4 years plus, okay? That's one thing that I see families make big mistakes about. They're like, oh yeah, we can afford $40,000. We have it for 1 year, okay? Remember, this is going to happen four times at least. So you're going to have to redo the FAFSA four times, you're going to have to pay four times, or 16 times, or however, whatever the payment plan is, okay? But it's something that you have to plan out of. I need to have a four-year, sometimes five-year plan of how we're going to afford college, okay? So that's something just to keep in mind. So just have that when you're budgeting. And you can always, if you have questions about certain schools' process or some of your top schools are starting to, you'll start hearing things like 100% need met. That's going to be like a Stanford, some of those big, the really hard schools to get into that are the statistically anomalies that you can probably not get into. They're going to, because of that, they're going to typically offer to, if you have need, that EFC, you're going to have to pay that EFC, but at, say, Stanford, they're going to say, you're going to pay $5,000, is that what your EFC says a year? After that, Stanford's going to foot the bill. So it's a great opportunity. That's the exception, not the rule. But you'll hear some things like that. We'll go in next year. We'll talk more about the financial aid and kind of what the specifics about financial aid look like in terms of different types of scholarships, what a loan is, what a grant is, and some more of that. Because that's later in the year, we won't necessarily look at that so much right now. But I wanted to give you guys a heads up. You should probably start having those conversations. You can always, again, call the financial aid office at certain schools you're looking at as well and get more of the skinny from them about what that specific school's policies are, what their history is. On this is going to be your average good questions to start asking if you're looking at or looking for online. So like average loan indebtedness is going to be something that schools have started to publish. What is the average amount of student loans students leave with at the end of the 4 years? Percent of students who receive non-loan aid, so merit aid or need-based aid. And again, financial aid, just like with the applications, has deadlines that are very specific and also very solid, not really budgeting or wavering. And again, look at 4 years. So, in this race, you're not the hare, you're going to be the tortoise. At least that's my hope. You're going to want to go fast, you're going to want to kind of bust through all this, but take your time and do the research and spend the time that you need to make sure that you have a lot of stuff done. For most of you guys, apart from typically getting married or divorced, this is going to be one of your biggest decisions you're going to make in your life. Going to college, getting your first job, what path you're going to take after high school. And that's a very scary prospect. And sometimes people are too lax about that prospect. Okay? So when I'm pressuring you guys of like, what are you guys thinking about? What are you guys doing? Like, it's not because I think you're lazy, but because you guys can't really afford to be lazy. All right, so you're going to miss out on opportunities. It's going to change. If you guys don't do certain things, it's going to change the course of your life. Doesn't mean that if you make a mistake or you do something wrong or make a decision that you want to change later that you can't change it. But for the next couple years, this is going to be a big, big, big decision. So we need to like make sure that the time and effort behind that. You know, you wouldn't just walk up to a house and go say, I'm going to buy that one because it's got a roof. Like, that's not really how you buy a house. So that's not how you should approach a college application either, because that's not how the college application works. Again, you need to sometimes make sacrifices to reach your goal. If your goal is a more pricey, maybe private school, that's great. And sometimes it's gonna mean, okay, if we really value this for our son or daughter, or if me as a student really values this, you know, I might have to make a decision. I should maybe sell my car. Maybe we sell our house and downsize because they're moving out or whatever it might be. We might, you know, you guys have to have some of those conversations, but we'd be willing to start making sacrifices if it's warranted to reach that goal. Again, mind your email. Not only I will be emailing you, colleges will start emailing you with things like reminders or deadlines or missing documentation. And if you're letting your emails gather to the things like I've seen them gather to, like 10,000 emails plus, okay, that's something you can start whittling down in the summertime as well. Because by August 1st, you guys, shoot for inbox zero. I know. Or at least clear all your, like, make them all red or something like that. So you know when new emails come in. Or start a new email address strictly for college applications. Okay, whatever that might be. And just a side note, guys, about emails, your school email will be around for 1 year after you graduate. Okay, so I do suggest using a non-school email address for things like college applications, financial aid, that kind of stuff, because many times you'll forget about your applications or your FAFSA or whatever it might be until the next year you need to use it, and that email is going to be gone, and there's not really a way to gather some of that stuff back if you don't have your email address anymore. Okay, so creating a professional email to use in your application. Yeah, you'd be surprised. Communicate. Ask us questions. Tell us what you need help with. Unfortunately, our degrees are not mind reading, so we need your help to tell us what you guys will need at times. Sometimes I can guess. Sometimes I know by the season and that kind of thing. But many times I can't tell what you're struggling with or what you're all stressed out about. Okay, so sometimes I'll ask you. Sometimes I'll let you kind of be stressed a little bit. But if you guys seriously tell us, we'll be able to help you a little bit better. Again, deadlines, we'll skip this. Kind of talked about this. One thing that I would suggest, maybe, especially for you guys, Selective Service, when you guys do your applications for financial aid, it's going to require you to have registered for the Selective Service. So you can get a head start on that.
And you guys?
I believe so. I don't remember.
I did. It's always been.
I don't remember that part about
this. It's required?
Tell me, guys.
Yes. Yeah. So you cannot submit your FAFSA without being registered for this Selective Service. If you wanted to pay for your whole thing, you can.
Girls do it?
I think so. I actually don't remember about girls. I just know it's a guy thing. But I'll have to do a little more research. Put that on the parking lot for me. So you guys, the draft stuff, hopefully that never happens. But
we could tomorrow.
Yes, for the draft. Many times you do that when you register to vote. This is one thing that I would suggest, and when I have meetings with you guys, hopefully next fall, we'll sit down and do this. Double check your transcripts for accuracy. Me and Blanca do really hard work to make sure that it's accurate, but every once in a while it's not. We're humans too, so sometimes a button gets pushed incorrectly or one number gets left off a course code, whatever it might be, and that would change a transcript from saying English, ELD1 to English at Sierra College or something like that. So double check that. The best way to do that, you guys have access on Aries to your transcripts, so just look through the classes on there. If we have a meeting, most likely as a senior, I'll print out your transcript. I usually give it to you to review. Just double check grades, make sure everything looks right. I don't anticipate any errors, but if there is, just let us know.
If a student has taken a Sierra College class and has grades sent here, when they go to apply, who sends in the Sierra College grade? You guys or Sierra College has it separately?
So, two different things. So, when you're applying, and it depends a little bit on the application that you're using, most applications are going to say high school credits and then college credits. So, typically students are going to put the Sierra College stuff in the college credits area. They're not usually going to ask for the official transcript for Sierra College if it's reported on our transcripts until the end. Sometimes they'll ask in kind of your to-do list of, please submit all transcripts, including college transcripts, or they'll give you a list of any transcripts that you have that are reporting grades on your application. Then you would need to order them from Sierra College. So the only thing that they're going to see from Sierra for us, it's going to be on, like it's listed on your transcript here. That's not going to give you any type of college credit. It will go towards meeting certain requirements, but most students are going to be required to order the Sierra College transcript at some point. It kind of depends on the college when that
is. So if we have one, then we still have to order it because it has to go officially?
Yes.
Okay.
So yeah, all the transcripts that we're talking about being sent to colleges or anybody, they're all official transcripts. So it's not something we can print out really. It's something that we do online electronically, either through your Novice account or parchment.com. Sierra College, you'd have to order it directly from Sierra College through your My Sierra portal, or by going to the school or something like that, they can do that. Wrapping up somewhat quickly, summer work that you guys can really get a head start on, like I said, SAT, ACT prep, and continued prep. Some of you guys have already started, and that's a good thing. If you haven't taken an SAT yet, I would encourage you to sign up. Summer is a great time to kind of bolster some of your scores. If you've taken it before, you kind of have a baseline. You can use summer to focus because they don't have summer SATs or ACTs. So you can use the PrepMe software. There's also other things online that you can access, as well as things like Clever Minds will have some things, classes that you can sign up for cost. Typically every fall, I'm assuming we'll probably do it again next year. We'll do an SAT prep, we'll bring them over here to do that during the school year, in the school day, like a little half day, a little seminar. Again, traveling, visiting schools, finding a meaningful volunteer, intern, or work experience. Okay, that's another way to bolster your application, because schools are going to look at things, pretty much anybody but the CSU, they're going to look at your extracurricular activities and stuff like that. Okay, so make sure that you find something that you can get some value out of, not just working at the bowling alley for money. You know, that's great, but if you can find something different or better, I would say that, other than the money aspect, if you find a non-paying internship, that's something that's going to be relevant, or even a volunteer opportunity, that's going to be much better than kind of like just a basic part-time job. So looking for some of those things, and again, research. Quick picture. So this is your Novice. This is like a close-up of a Novice account. I just wanted to show you where PrepMe is. So when they log into their account, this is on the homepage. So they can click that. It's going to open a new window. Okay. One thing that kind of gets people stuck in the ruts about PrepMe, it's going to ask you if you haven't started yet to do 3 diagnostic tests. That's not the program. Okay. It's going to take 3 tests from you. And the nice thing about that is it's going to kind of get results back, and it's not going to waste your time on stuff that you're good at. It's going to focus on the stuff that, based on how you answer these diagnostics, what you need to work on the most. Okay, and then the program actually starts. So don't get stuck and hung up on this sucks, I don't like these 3 quick tests. You know, really focus on what comes after that. Complete those quick tests. And then make sure, if you have an idea of when your next test date is, it'll set up a plan of study for you. It's going to say, okay, October or something is your test, your next SAT. To get through the entire kind of prep program, this is the amount of time each week you're going to need to spend, and actually set up specific dates and stuff like that. You can actually log in and get through the entire program. So it's a really good tool. It's not used like I would hope it would get used, so I'd encourage you guys to take advantage of it. There's a whole bunch of links here too. Top is mainly my links. At the bottom, there's some links to different college websites that you can use as well. So I highly encourage you guys to check some of those out. Those are great research tools. I'm gonna skip this till next year, I think. That's stuff that you can't access yet, and we're out of time. So, any questions? Let's see if there's parking lot questions, or any questions that you guys have. All right. So one question is this: is the student Novice account different than the family account? So all the students have an account. If you don't, for some reason you can't access it, come talk to me. I can reset passwords and stuff and make sure your email's all right. But there is a difference between a student. So parents can have access to a Novice account, to essentially their student's Novice account, to use some of the same tools. It's a little more limited, it won't let you update certain things. However, the reason why we don't mass give out parent accounts is because our ARI system doesn't collect the information that we need to be able to do that. So if you would like your own account, pretty much all it's going to need from you is you to send me an email saying, can you get me on my kid's Novice account, and an email that you'd like to use. I can then send you a code that you can create your account with. OK? So look, it's basically the same thing. You can also just ask for a kid if they're willing to share their account information with you. That's another popular way to do it, but I can definitely set that up for you if you want. Our recommendation letter is sent directly to the school admissions office, or is a copy given to the student to distribute it to all applications. So because they're confidential, part of that thing that I skipped through talked about FERPA. FERPA is the Family Educational Rights Privacy Act or something along those lines. FERPA basically is why we can't just like give you student information, you know, just because you asked for it if it's not your kid. You know, there's a lot of actual rules and laws about privacy and your students' information. Parents and guardians are the ones that, you know, have access to those types of things. And because of that, you know, I can't necessarily even release kids' transcripts to certain schools without, you know, there's a FERPA waiver that essentially, with most of these applications that you're going to sign, that allows me to release student information to schools. So with recommendations, part of the thing about recommendations is most of them, if you do not sign FERPA, basically, and there's another kind of waiver that you'll sign too that has to do specifically about recommendations. If you do not sign those, one, I can't, if without the FERPA, I can't send it. They won't let you get past that process. So basically, you have to sign FERPA to let us do that. But two, regarding the recommendations, if you basically say, I would like to have access to all my recommendations and application data after the fact, many people view, and many teachers would view that as, we probably would not write quite the review that we would write if you didn't allow it to be confidential. That's part of the power of a recommendation, is knowing that students won't always have access to that recommendation. We can feel free to write their strengths. Some teachers will choose to write certain things that are weaknesses that they can grow, most won't, but you know, it's something that having it be directly between the school and the university will provides better confidence on the university's behalf that this is an accurate representation of the student. Otherwise, if it's kind of like, you know, they see that they didn't check the box of I want to check this later, they kind of view it as, well, they probably just wrote it because they want, you know, they know their parents are going to look at it later and might come back and get mad at the school if they write something they don't like. So that's kind of the purpose of that. But yes, we send that directly to the schools. Any type of application that happens for recommendations, we'll go through either Naviance or other kind of typically digital process. So the students will typically not ever have to like mail a recommendation. Very rare instances that'll happen. It's always good to get a couple copies though that are sealed, because sometimes scholarships that'll come out in the spring will request a letter of recommendation, and they're usually general. When we write letters, they're general. Dear admissions committee, here's the qualities about the student. We don't usually do kind of like really specific, unless it's, you know, for a military academy or something like that. That's like 200 members per person or whatever it might be. So two good questions. Any other questions at all?
I have one on the online application. Are they in a portal where you can go in and work on it for a while and then hold on to it and go back? And
yes.
So you can get some basics going over the summer and come back to the things.
Yes and no about the second part of the question. So yes, they're online in a place where you can save it. And I can't say all of them, but the ones that I've all seen have, you can go through. You don't have to like submit it on one go. You can save your progress. Sometimes you have to get to the bottom of a page to get through it. Other times, it's you know, you can hit save at any part, and it's going to let you exit out and come back. The save button is big. Do not ever hit a back button on your browser when you're doing applications. That's going to screw it up. So just be careful. Always use the in application buttons to move forward and backwards, and always hit save before you go onto the next page. I don't want you to work for an hour filling something in and then have it lost. Also, guys, this is a problem for students I've seen. Don't leave an application open for like 3 days and then expect it to still be there when you come back. Okay? The application, internet times out, meaning that it's going to close you after a certain amount of time. So if you're going to like leave it up and want to show me later or something like that, you're going to have to save it and log out and then log back in when you're ready to show us. Okay? Or else we're going to do stuff on there and then we're going to click something and say, oh, timed out. Go start from the beginning. Log back in. Kind of circling back to the second half of that question. So yes, you can always typically save on these applications. However, most of the applications are not out yet. So the common application, I believe it's August 1st that will come out, if my memory serves. So any type of account that you create at this point, it won't roll over. So I wouldn't suggest creating that yet. You might want to just maybe focus on looking at the essays and that kind of thing, and maybe start kind of drafting an idea maybe on your drive or something like that, where you can lay that in later. Most of the work isn't in the actual filling out of the application. It's mostly in some of the supplemental stuff that comes with it. The application itself is, you know, like trying to apply for a driver's license. You need your transcript, your legal information, some of the other stuff will come out later, and you'll have plenty. It's usually plenty of time to fill that out. Same thing with like the CSU and UCs. They're not going to come out until later in the fall. So really getting on them now, they're not going to be available to do that at this point. If you find one, they're probably this year's and not the one that you're going to develop anyways.
So the criteria for the essays, are those accessible so that
if you got online for the Common App in particular, and the UC personal statements are the same every year.
Okay.
So if you got online to the Common App, you probably could find them on the Common App website, but if you just Google 2015, 2016 Common App essays, essay topics, it'll pop up as probably the first Google result up there. Just make sure it's from the Common App, not some random website.
So the Common App does require an essay.
Yes. And then so you'll have a general Common App essay, and then you'll have some of the schools might have specific supplemental essays that you might have to write for the specific school.
And that's also for schools outside of the state,
yes.
Too.
Yes. Okay. Outside of the state, it's kind of like a whole new game. Every school system has their own little like intricacies. And
so go to the school site to see whether they accept the Common App, and then from there find out.
Yeah. Do you have a question?
I just answered.
Okay. Any other questions? Good question.